And today is a very special day. On 2nd December 1942, this Chain reaction, which was first demonstrated by Enrico Fermi. So we have a special lecture on this to mark this historic and occasion. To commemorate this, we have with us Dr. Paresh Vaidya. But before that, to start the program, I will request Director Nehru Science Center, Sri Shiv Prasad Kennerji, to say a few words, welcome all the guests and the speaker. Sir.
Thank you, Umesh. Good afternoon and good evening to all our esteemed audience who are on the virtual platform. And of course, good afternoon and good evening to all our esteemed members of the National Center for Science Communicators, in whose collaboration we are organizing this event to commemorate the World Nuclear Energy Day. My colleague Umesh actually briefly informed you that today, the 2nd December, commemorates the World Nuclear Energy Day in memory of Enrico Fermi's first baby pile, which perhaps was the first controlled nuclear chain reaction that happened on 2nd December, way back in 1942. And the rest we know is history, which was followed by Hiroshima, Nagasaki. In a way, Dr. Vaidya is going to be speaking on the subject Enrico Fermi, his baby pile and after. It has a great relevance for India. If you really look at the Indian science and technology movement post the scientific renaissance that we had, which started from Bengal, which produced one of the best, most eminent scientists like Raman, J.C. Bose, Meghnad Saha, Satyendranath Bose, Acharya Praful Chandra Ray and all. The actual post-independent scientific movement in India primarily began with Homi Bhabha. Homi Bhabha and his vision for the nuclear energy. Even the Indian Space Research Organization, which comes into the limelight each and every time it succeeds, which it does quite often, is actually a spin-off benefit from BRC or TIFR or the nuclear energy movement that started in India by Homi Bhabha. So it will be an interesting lecture by Professor Dr. Vaidya. Before I hand over the mic to Dr. Paresh Vaidyaji to talk about Enrico Fermi, his baby pile, and after, I would request my colleague Umesh Kumar to briefly introduce the speaker. Umesh.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for setting the tone and giving the orientation. Now, it's a privilege for me to introduce Dr. Paresh Vaidya, who is a graduate from Gujarat University in Physics and then MSc and PhD from University of Mumbai, and joined BARC, the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, through 13th batch of training school, and retired from there in 2009 as head quality control of nuclear fuels and nuclear reactor subsystems of various germs and designs. Dr. Vaidya is basically a science communicator as well. He has written over 160 articles and science columns in Gujarati, English, 6 books on various topics, a biography of Isaac Newton for Orient Longman publishers, radio talks in Gujarati and Hindi. He was also a member of advisory panel of All India Radio Bombay for Science and Technology Broadcast. He is also founder member of National Center for Science Communicators, in which whose collaboration we are organizing this today's special lecture. He has been active with Society of Clean Environment, worked with Lok Vigyan Sankhan, which is a people's science movement organization working for taking up people's issue related to science. He has organized a 20-day foot march on same route of the famous Gandhi March of Mahatma Gandhi in the Golden Jubilee year of the march in 1980, which was particularly used to talk to people on subject of scientific temper and health, among others. So with this brief introduction, I'll request Dr. Paresh Vaidya to start his deliberation and start sharing screen. Over to you, Dr. Vaidya. Sir, you unmute.
Okay, I unmuted. Am I audible? Yes. Thank you and Kennerji, and also thanks to Nehru Science Center as well as NCSC to get me here and give me chance to talk to all the friends. What I'm seeing is most of the people are friends and not many students for whom I tuned the PowerPoint. But anyway, it's information a priori, so now we can modulate as per what we need. You know, already the importance of the day has been told by Mr. Mr. Kumar. Now I come with the slides. This picture is a view of Baba Atomic Research Center. I know half the audience here has seen this. This is a first reactor in India called Cyrus. Of course, it was second reactor. Apsara was first. This is much later, Dhruva, which is the largest research reactor. And why this slide is first is because I have spent almost 4 decades here, and whatever I learned in science and whatever I learned in nuclear science both was here as part of my job. So today we will be talking about first reactor. I mean, these reactors are very large. This is still larger. And how do I go to the next slide? Yeah, 1 minute. Okay. Okay, we will go to the. I think there is some. Okay. So what I plan is we will go through the history of first chain reaction. What circumstances were there when the fission was invented, and then from fission a chain reaction, from chain reaction the establishment of chain reaction by Fermi on this day almost 1 hour back 78 years ago. And then at the end, if I feel that I have not done enough justice to the present state of affairs, I request the chairman NCSC, Dr. Jayaraman, to complete whatever is the use of reactors today. I mean, I will leave with the history, and I request him to connect us with the present things. Okay. Now, I'm able to see my, how do I take these pictures up? I'm not able to see my screen, maybe. Okay. It started like this. Moment Fermi achieved criticality. I'll tell you what is criticality. Most of the people are mature here. They are not students, so most of them know what is criticality. There was a message from Arthur Compton, a famous physicist. He was the head of MATLAB in Manhattan Project, to some person, administrative boss, okay, National Defense Committee. He says the Italian navigator arrived at the shores of the New World. So, opponent asks, how are the natives? He means, how are the neutrons? And are you all right with them? They are very friendly. That means they are all under control, because neutrons, if they are not under control, entire area around that would have perhaps molten. Who was the navigator? Navigator is, of course, Fermi. Now, this is Fermi, and this is the picture of the first reactor. Now you look at it, this is all about the reactor. There are blocks of graphite, and look at the size, it's almost 10, 12 feet long and something. And what about the controls? All that about the control is he's having some Geiger-Müller counter in his hand, which counts the either radiation or neutron counters are separately kept, and some chart recorder was put there to see the counts of the neutrons coming in. Now you compare that situation here. This is our very recent nuclear reactor, Kakra Par 3 in Gujarat, 700 megawatt, I think almost more than 1,000 times or 5,000 times larger than one. Look at the control room. How many meters and how many indicators? And you need some 6 people to man this place. So, but any journey starts with first step. So what Fermi did on 2nd December 1942 was the first step. You may walk 1,000 kilometers, you may walk 1 kilometer. First step is first step. And this is what it shows. It where we have come, and this is Indian reactor. We are not even showing some foreign reactor for the sake of showing. Of course, we have 1,000 megawatt reactor also at Kudankulam, and some people have even 1,500 outside India. But all that started on 2nd December because a chain reaction was tested. Chain reaction means one atom breaks, the next atom can break, then third can break, etc. You will again see the physics ahead. When Swami finished this work, what did he prove? He, very first thing he proved, last 30 years, whatever happened in physics, he one by one confirmed in one go. Nature of atom is seen by Rutherford. What Rutherford saw, there is an atom in which center is nucleus, which is almost all the mass of the atom, and there are some electrons around it. This is all about the atom. More was not known at that time, but that we'll see. But he also proved neutrons. There is a particle called neutrons, and there were theoretical, even experimental proofs were there, but now there was a proof that everything became hot, but was planned. Then phenomenon of fission. Somebody said uranium breaks into two. Yes, it must be breaking because the whole pile had become critical, as again the word critical comes. Then Einstein's equation E is equal to mc squared. When uranium atom breaks, some mass is missing. And that mass becomes energy, 200 MeV of energy. And that kind of energy for billions of atoms breaking there, you get high temperature, and that is how the reactors work. So in one go, and of course, what he was trying to do was establishing a chain reaction under his control. And that also he did. So he proved so many things when that evening he finished his experiment. The story started with neutron. Before neutron, atom was a very simple neutron. Atom was a very simple atom, nucleus and electronics. In 1932, Chadwick, he found that there is a particle did not have charge, has some mass almost equal to proton, and that is a member of the nucleus. So far nucleus was not known, but some positively charged stuff was there. Now it could be all protons, nobody knew. So it is only after Chadwick, when he found, when he hit beryllium with alpha particle, saw something coming out, it did not have charge, and that's what was neutron. Then that neutron created a lot of curiosity. Those were the days when everybody in the field of modern science, that time it was called modern physics, today it is 100 year old, everybody wanted to do something. Already the previous 30 years, 1900 to 1930, 1895 to 1955, George Gamow has written a book called 30 Years That Shook Physics. Now, what we can now tell today for this lecture is 1932, when neutrons were invented, to 1945, 13 years that shook the earth, not even physics. It changed the equations in not only science, but it changed the equations in politics. It changed the equations in even the manner of life between countries. So the whole thing changed in those 13 years. And with some restrictions of our emotions, we will look at it, how that developed. But now at least we know that the atom, which Rutherford had seen, has become complete now with neutrons inside the nucleus. Now, once this was seen, our friend Fermi, on whose memory today we are talking, he thought, if I push neutron into uranium atom, now that time, so this is the periodic table of natural elements, but this periodic table is beyond nature. It starts from 1, goes up to 92, where my arrow is. Beyond 92, this never existed, this does not exist even today in nature. So uranium was the last atom. Its atomic number was 92. And if you can push a neutron in that, then you get the next number and the next number. This was the curiosity Fermi started his work. Fermi was that time in Italy. He was in University of Rome, and the work he started was there. Now, this is meant for students. I'll quickly skip it. How do you show atoms? You name of the element. This is the atomic weight, and this is the atomic number. This is the number of protons. Same number of electrons also will be moving around. But this includes this 88, and additionally some more, they are neutrons. This is how an atom's notation is made. And when atoms' reactions are shown, they are shown like this. Suppose I have 77 iridium 192. I add the neutron, which is zero charge, one mass number. It becomes 78 platinum 193. But then it emits beta particle. We'll see how and why. And then becomes stable and something like that. So these notations were meant for students. Luckily, all people here are knowledgeable, and we don't spend time on that. What Fermi did, like Thomas Alva Edison did. Thomas Alva Edison, when he found that something glows when you pass current, so before reaching tungsten, he tried every other fiber in the nature, or not even in nature, which is man-made also. Like that, Fermi started with all elements and started bombarding them with the with neutron, seeing that what happens. Uranium was his one agenda, but before that also, then that actually I predated that. First he did this, then only he comes to uranium. When he started doing that, there was indeed something. What happened was, there was some instability in the nucleus, and nucleus started emitting either gamma ray plus beta ray, or gamma ray plus positive beta particle, something used to happen. So radioactivity, which was so far seen only in natural materials, now some artificial radioactivity came. Okay, that was, of course, a few months before Fermi does that. These people also had done. Some other people, Joliot, Curie, and France, they had also, what they had done was bombarded with alpha particles, and radioactivity was generated. That was also artificial radioactivity. But Fermi did it with neutrons. So he found almost 63 elements out of the 92 of naturally occurring elements, because the remaining may be gas, or he may not be able to get enough cross section perhaps. So he did everything like that, and plenty of data he got. Plenty of data. His mind then turned to uranium, whereas his colleague won Segre. This man is Segre. He stuck to the radioactivity creation, artificial radioactivity, and what happens when neutron is absorbed by a nucleus. So that is a separate branch. We will look at him and come back to him. This place is just outside University Rome, where they did the work. If you read the biography of Fermi written by his wife Laura Fermi, she has written, she has described the excitement of this experiment. When something becomes radioactive, it's not always like uranium decays in thousands of years or millions of years. Some byproducts may decay in few seconds. Some may decay in few minutes. So these people were given one room for experiment, and across the corridor, somewhere else, they had set up these Geiger counters which measure the radiation. So they will take the foil which is bombarded and then run to that place so that the decay is not much and their counting activity is enough. So after all, the instrumentation was built by them. They were not very efficient instruments like today. Today you can even measure microcurie. And that excitement, and that is why you see they are here, and the camaraderie is generated. Some of them are students, this is for me, the teacher or boss or whatever you call it. This man is called Rossetti, did some work on emulsions or something. Okay. Now, what this man, Emilio Segre, learned, and he declared something called, there is a chart called Segre chart. Okay, the physicists are familiar with this, that plots a curve between number of neutrons versus number of protons. So when neutron number is equal to proton, you get like this. This is the line. Okay, but it doesn't happen in nature. Nature, this is the element number one, element number two, element number three, like that it goes through the periodic table. Okay, as the atomic number increases, you go to the right of the chart. Now what it means is, instead of this, you reach here. So number of neutrons is more than number of protons. All the elements beyond first few elements, all the elements in nature have higher neutron numbers. And that is how a stability is achieved. And that is the subject of nuclear physics. And this taught the physicists of that time how to study the structure of nucleus. We are not into that today. Okay. So this green line, every square shows a stabilizer. Stabilizer means which is not real. It just remains like that. You know, iron is iron, always iron. Unless you take iron 57 or something which decays. Otherwise, iron 56 just stays. So these are. But if neutrons are higher, what Segre says, if neutrons are higher, it starts emitting beta particles. Neutrons are lower, you can always make something radioactive in such a way that it emits positive charge. And it's a nucleus from what we had 1 minute. So, correct. Yes. The elements from go up, they have lesser neutrons, okay? And go down, they have higher neutrons. But if you look at the periodic table, the atomic number reduces one like this, okay? One like that. So, what we saw, platinum would become iridium if suppose one proton goes out. But if in iridium, if one neutron comes and one beta ray goes out, it becomes platinum. So that is, a negative charge goes out, it is assumed that one proton is added in the nucleus. It's not as simple as that what we talk, but that's a crude explanation. And that becomes a new element. So it goes to the next element, next element, next element, like that it happens. So Segre made a chart. That was one outcome. And these two things are outcomes which we already talked about. Fermi was actually a theorist originally, before he landed on this job, and then till his end he remained experimentalist. But beginning he was a theorist, so he gave a beta decay theory. Why he had to give a theory of beta decay? Because beta particles were not of same energy. When a gamma ray comes out from a nucleus, one particular energy comes out. The cobalt 60 is 1.1 millimeters, it will always be 1.1. Well, here what used to happen is beta of every energy was coming out. Today I may get 20 keV, tomorrow I may get 22 keV. So that was intriguing for the physicists. And Fermi gave a theory in which he said, that theory is somewhere here. He says, if I add neutron to some element that equal to or that symbol is missing here, please. So a negatively charged particle comes out. This element becomes some other element because its atomic number and atomic weight both are different, and something else comes out. This is a particle called neutrino. It was already predicted by Pauli earlier, but that was a theory. Now there was an experimental support that if you want to explain the theory of beta decay, you have to assume that some particle called neutrino comes out when a nucleus decays to beta particle. So that's fine. So this is one more thing found from the experiments. What was to come further, we'll still see. But this work was good enough for me to get him a Nobel Prize for creating artificial radioactivity. Okay, as we have seen this. What is this prize for? The prize for the discovery of radioactive radioactivity produced by neutron radiation and the discovery of nuclear reactions for fast slow neutrons. Of course, he tried all sorts of neutrons. He tried fast neutrons, slow neutrons. Now, here is the catch. The history and science are now trying to conflict with each other or collaborating with each other, whatever way you look at it. Fermi had no problem in the country where she was in. She was an Italian, and Italy was ruled by a dictator, okay? Mussolini, everybody knows. Now, Fermi was all right there, and he was given sufficient respect. He had some difficulty because his wife was not welcome in that country, and there were some rules by which, you know, she cannot work, she had to give up her job. So Fermi was not, and then, you know, scientists are generally free-minded. They, even if there is a reasonable restriction, he didn't like it. So what he did was, when he got the chance to migrate, he took that chance. To take the Nobel Prize, he went to Stockholm, but he went with all bag and baggage and auto visa. And for a few days, he stayed there and then applied for US visa and went away to USA in January 1939. I think he reached the USA and he had already planned a job with Columbia University at that time. Now, my arrow is very slow, so please follow me. This is map of Europe. America was yet to become superpower, and America was yet to be scientifically more advanced in Europe that time. Our story will go around Europe to see Britain. Chadwick was studying something and he found neutrons. Those neutrons in Italy, Rome, University of Rome, Fermi used them and found something. Then further up, we will see all these countries. This is Germany, this is Denmark, this is France, this is Hungary, and Poland, of course, I have marked only because Marie Curie was from there, otherwise Poland is nowhere. Yes, Switzerland is an important place. We will visit it in a while. So now, when Fermi reached there, USA, it was January 1939, but his work was discussed everywhere, and there was one Kaiser Wilhelm Institute in Berlin, in Germany, where Otto Hahn, this man, was working, and he was head of physics department. This madam was Lise Mittner, she was head of physics department, he was head of chemistry department. Now both of them were looking at that periodic table. They also tried to hit uranium with neutrons. And their idea was, if you hit neutrons on uranium atom, like uranium decays to radium, you know, there's a famous series, radium series, you know, alpha particle, sometimes proton, sometimes gamma. Something goes on decaying and you reach a new element called radium. That was the natural radioactive material known to people that time. Of course, uranium was radioactive. But what Curie did from Poland was extracting the radium and showing it to the world. Now, these people, when doing this work, they found something else is seen. So they were hoping that instead of transurine element, I'll show you that first and then go back. In this periodic table, what the gentleman thought, Fermi, same thing these people thought, if uranium can be made this or this or this, be nice. But okay, if we did not succeed, what you will expect? Uranium might have become protactinium or thorium or actinium or something like that. At the most, it can become radium. This entire line actually is sitting here. 14 elements have come out of here because they all have similar property. They are called actinides. So this place, in the periodic table, the residence is here. In one room kitchen, 14 people are staying. Now, he thought, alpha particle may come out, one photon may come out, something may happen. But if I have not done any mistake, if I don't get neptunium or plutonium, I can at least get the radium. Okay, that is what Hahn was thinking. But he was confused. What he got was something else. Umesh sir, you are there. I want to remove this. I'm not able to read my own. Okay.
Tell me which one?
No. Okay. I'm now able to read. I wanted to read my write-up and this photographs are coming in between. Okay. Thank you. I have done it. Okay. Now, you see how science was there. This I have picked up only because I thought some teachers and some students will be listening to it, and they may even now listening YouTube later. 19th December night, Hahn is writing a letter to Mitner. Now, what had happened between last slide and this slide is, Hahn was told as the director of Kaiser Wilhelm Institute that please discharge Mitner. Mitner can no more work with our institute. That was the German government's order to him. So he had to discharge Mitner. Now, what Mitner did? Mitner was already 59-year-old, a spinster at that age, okay? And one fine morning, he is told to leave the job and leave the country. Of course, he was not told to leave the country, but he was told to leave the job. First, he was robbed of a post of head of department, and then they said, nothing, you have to sit down. With the good offices of Hahn and some good officers from the police, she smuggled herself to Sweden, and she went to Denmark and then went over to Sweden. What was Sweden? In Sweden, no, sorry, first where she went to Sweden later. First she went to Denmark, and Denmark man, the father figure, Niels Bohr was there. He was nowadays we are seeing a lot of langar being put in lockdown period by some people from Punjab. Like that, he was a refugee camp for all the scientists who he had said, anybody who has a difficulty for his government can come down to my lab in Bohr, had his own lab in Stockholm, and he will keep them. But anyway, Mitner went to him and then went over to Sweden and looked for a job in an institute. Now, we will come back how that job haunts her later. But now come back to Hahn. What Hahn is saying, now Mitner is in Sweden. She is waiting for Christmas, and her nephew, Otto Frisch, is another physicist. He is also joining her, and this man is writing a letter on 19th December, which reaches them only, because it's a surface mail those days, there is no courier or anything. So what he writes, it is now, well, don't try to read, I'll read and then you can hear. It is now just 11 o'clock at night. At a quarter to 12, Strassman will be coming so that I can see about going home. Strassman is his junior. Okay? He is also a collaborator. The fact is, there is something so odd about the radium isotope that for the time being, we are telling you, only you, about it. That they are calling it radium isotope because that is what, because it was radioactive, and maybe that is the. Our radium isotope is behaving just like barium. I mean, it looks like a joke. A chemist of a highest order saying that our radium isotope is behaving just like barium. That uranium nucleus can't really burst asunder from barium to form barium. Okay. Now see what he's saying. And it is written. Of course, it is written in a letter which is in the custody of Mitner's family and friends. But he is telling that uranium cannot break. Uranium fission is not possible. We all know that uranium nucleus can't really burst asunder to form barium. But now we are going to see whether the actinium isotope formed by our radium are in fact to behave like actinium, or again like lanthanum down below, you know, number only 56, whereas actinium is 91. Not actinium is 91, of course, actinium is maybe 89 or something. So he is saying, okay, already radium is confusing us. I hope the other one, I hope to see actinium if some alpha particle has come out. Yeah, I hope that fellow doesn't be like lanthanum. And all highly tricky experiments. I have got to get back to the counters now. So he said, now I am. I'm sorry, my telephone line. Okay. So now he says, now I will go back to counter because they are counting radioactivities. Okay. So now what he says, after a while, I mean, 20th December, 20th December, they really found actinium was not actinium. See, they can do atomic weight experiment. That was really lengthy. And then 22nd December, they sent a paper away. Those days, papers were sent very fast. They sent a paper made to be Staffen, is a famous German science physics magazine. It appeared on 16 January. It's a horrifying conclusion, contradicting all known tenets of nuclear physics. I mean, a scientist is writing down this in a paper. Okay. Now you look at what was his problem. Like all actinides are sitting from this point, and we have shown it here, courtesy of Dr. Jayaraman, this periodic table is all the way up to 118, and I was updated up to 109 yesterday. And all these lanthanides, they are all rare earths. They are sitting in one spot here. Now, first man is lanthanum. Okay. He says, if plutonium is breaking and suddenly I am seeing barium instead of radium, I hope instead of actinium, I don't see lanthanum. And it is a chance that one of the fission products, when uranium atom breaks, some fission products or various fission products. One of the fission products is lanthanum also. So he was absolutely stumped like a fastball. That not only barium is confusing, now actinium also is behaving like a. So now his article appeared in January 19th of 1939. Okay, but lot of things happened before that. On the day of Christmas, Otto Frisch reached the Sweden to his Tubi in Bua. And in his biography, he says, we were walking in a woods. They are all nice countries. Snow is coming and we are sitting on a dry wood. And we are discussing what is this problem with barium or radium of harm. And what they said again, same thing. Chris admitted, realized the barium atom size is about half of the uranium atom. Too many radiation chippings cannot happen. One alpha particle, second alpha particle, how long? From 92 to you cannot reach. So no, that's not possible. It's only possible is uranium atom is 22. Now this is unheard of. Nobody has heard an atom breaking into two equal parts so far. Then they were physicists of a very high rank. They quickly calculated that the amount of mass which is missing by, you know, adding up lanthanum and barium and looking at the mass of uranium, there is something going away, which is going in the air. Where is it? Oh, that is what the P is equal to mc square. The mass m which is missing is actually the energy. Well, energy goes where? Energy goes with neutrons, energy goes with the breakup parts of the fission, and that is the energy which we use in the nuclear reactors. But, okay, now that will come later after Fermi. I am jumping. So this was something very great. So they also wrote a paper in Nature, 11th and 18th February, two parts, Frisch and Mittner. Keep monitoring this name, Otto Frisch, Lise Mittner. There is a paper which says fission occurs. Okay, new type of nuclear reaction. Two unfortunate fellows, Tugge and Droste, also they thought like that, but they didn't write a paper very fast. Okay, but much more unfortunate one girl. No, Ida Nodak, Taki was her husband, Ida Nodak. This lady, when Fermi first gave out the theory and wrote a paper that I am confused, then she wrote a paper, Hubert Das element 90, about in element 93. When Fermi is looking for transuranic element 93, she says whatever he is seeing is okay. It is conceivable that these heavy nuclei break up into several large fragments, which of course the isotopes of non-elements, but not neighbors of irradiated element. Not like what Hahn and Strassmann were thinking, somewhere nearby, protactinium, actinium, something like that, maybe something away. Now this lady did not she wrote this, but did not pursue. Look at the fun. Her paper, Fermi didn't read it immediately. After some time, he read it and he ignored it. Yeah. Much, much later, we are seeing, much, much later on the day of retirement, I have seen some of his lectures and also his friend, whom we have seen, Segre. He has said, Fermi dismissed this because he just didn't think that nucleus can break. Anyway, so Fermi was also not lucky. Now, the part which I want to highlight is Nobel Prize for Hahn and Strassmann for discovery of fission happened in 1945. Ida Noddack missed it fine. She didn't talk about it. Luge Doste missed it fine. But Lise Meitner was not listed under Nobel Prize. Now, that reason has been discussed enough and enough, and that is a long story, and we will not digress on that because our time is today for Fermi, but some other day. That was a very sorry state of affairs. Probably some kind of jealousy in Sweden. The very fact he was in Sweden, in an institute where another person was sitting as a nominator for the Nobel Prize winner, he preferred to ignore next door neighbor, though she had all the claims. After all, much later she wrote to a person saying that Hahn didn't know he had done fission. Hahn told me what he had done and I told it was fission. Now, this is how the Nobel Prize stories can be a subject of almost a dozen lectures apart. So we'll come back to chain of fission. So you have a nuclear fission. Can you make a chain out of those fission reactions? One atom breaks, then two breaks, then four breaks. Yeah, if you can make it, that is wonderful. What you must prove? You must prove that at what energy fission happens. Because when atom breaks, very large energy comes out, 200 MeV. That is what Lise Meitner had predicted. And also, how many neutrons are coming out? After all, in a chain reaction, all the new neutrons cannot go to another uranium. After all, uranium also has too many isotopes, at least two major isotopes, 235, 238. Somebody may go to 238, somebody may go to 235. No. So, these things have to be found. Now, Niels Bohr, just after Christmas, after receiving this lady, he came to USA for a seminar. And he muttered out, their paper of fission was to come out in 19 January. And that had come out, perhaps people have not noticed. 26 January, this man says something. And say the impact was so much that people left his lecture half and ran to their lab to confirm whether there are extra neutrons. If there are extra neutrons, they can take the credit of changing. That is all. So anyway, they decided that thermal fission cannot happen. Much later, somebody said, no, it can be. But now I want to show something which is not important for today's lecture, but someday we will have chance to talk more on this subject. Is when this was happening, same time, Germany attacks Czechoslovakia, Bohemia, Slovakia, Moravia, and
Umesh, is there any problem?
No, sir. All of a sudden, I think unka sound band hua hai. I have to check.
Jairaman sir, would you like to take this because it looks like his line is disconnected. Unmute sir. Jairaman sir, unmute.
ये क्या हुआ? ये कुछ है तुम्हारे disconnect हुआ? वो चले गए. I think
disconnect.
I think sir unka disconnect hua. He is not visible now even on participant list, I believe. Hello,
I can hear you, but Jairaman sir, I am not able to hear you. Vaidya sir, you can start again. You can continue.
Yeah, unmute, sir. Unmute kariye. Vaidya sir, unmute kariye.
Okay, I unmuted.
Yeah. No, again it is muted.
Is it okay now? Am I heard?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Okay, now I have to go to the particular slide. Did I share the screen?
Yeah, screen is it is there.
Yeah, I have to locate where I go. I'm sorry, this is MTNL. Anyway, pray that it is on the last.
No issue, okay. It happens sometime.
That's okay, we agree. Okay, so we will quickly pass to it. We are already 45 minutes over, actually, I'm supposed to end over. But anyway, you pardon me for some more minutes, maybe around 15 minutes you'll give me.
Okay. Another 5 to 10 minutes more, because we can have some questions also if in case.
So we will skip this basic theory of chain reaction. Everyone knows it, okay? But anyway, it was known that chain reaction can be established, and these are the physics of that. Okay. Now let me go to this. Okay. So now there is a branching point. Some people say we will use only peaceful and constructive use. And some people say, oh, no, if some other people may make bomb, why not we make? So that can be done only with the passing. There's a person called Leo Szilard. He was a extremely different kind of scientist. This man is called Szilard. He is from Hungary. When he was born and brought up, he was in a dictator's country. Then he was fed up, he went to Germany. By the time he settles in Germany, Germany also had a dictator's thing. Then he came to Austria, and Austria was also taken over by Germany. So that man was so bitter in life. And surprise of surprises, here is the person who has patented the concept of chain reaction in 1934, when neutrons were invented. When Fermi was working. So now all the people, including Fermi, have to go to Szilard to do more work on chain reaction, because he has a patent. Although he was generous, he didn't say have to hold the patent, but he said you people must work on chain reaction, because that's an important subject. So he says now we have to work. So where is the uranium? So I'll cut short. So he goes to Einstein. And tells Einstein, why don't you request the government of USA to procure some uranium from some country with which we can work? And he borrowed some £2,000 from some bank to work on chain reaction. Okay. Now I'll skip this letter of Einstein, because that's a very lovely letter, and most of the people here are senior adults, they know this letter. That is a letter where Einstein, who was once upon a time a pacifist, said, please allow us to work on chain reaction. Please arrange for some uranium. Some people are willing to work on it. And of course, he talked to Queen of Belgium and got some uranium released. And uranium came. And Szilard had the control of that uranium. But he joined Fermi. So this 2nd December party, Fermi and Szilard are equal on it. Okay. And how this pile is made? It's a very crude nuclear reactor. We have seen nuclear reactors today. You know, there are hundreds of materials, different tubes and tube into tube, and fuel is different. And then there are some absorbers, and there are some structural material of metal or steel. Here there are only 4 materials. Just 4 materials. 6 tons of uranium metal. How they put uranium metal? They didn't know how to roll uranium metal. They just took uranium powder, compacted it, centered it, something like that. And they made spheres of uranium or cylinders of uranium. 400 tons of graphite. What was graphite? They make a graphite block, put a hole in which they put the uranium. And of course, uranium oxide, uranium. And how to control the chain reaction? Control if it runs away, then cadmium can absorb neutrons. They knew that. So on the wooden stick, they have wrapped the cadmium. Cadmium is a very malleable material. You can wrap it like a stick. And That is how they inserted in reaction. And morning of 2nd December, he collected, of course, first he made file in Columbia University, but it could not become critical because his graphite was unclean. So he bought this good graphite and took the file to Chicago. And that is, now this is what a criticality I just explained in about a minute or so. See, number of neutrons goes on increasing, okay? Now as the time goes, the number of neutrons remain constant, we call it, it is just critical. Means you have one, two, three neutrons come out, one is used for the next fission, another two are lost, you don't care. But at least one should be available. But when a reactor starts operating, it may happen that neutrons may get absorbed somewhere here and there. And that is what happened in Chicago, in Columbia. The chain reaction starts when it dies out because the neutrons are lost. He put 1,000 neutrons and after the 2 seconds, he has only 10 because all others are scattered away without making a new fission. Whereas if you don't control it, 2, 4, 8, 16, 256, 1024, they will run away. And before you do anything, the whole thing may become superheated and a lot of radiation, you may die, materials may melt. This is called supercritical. So reactors don't work like that. Reactors work in the green. So that is why the word criticality, it is just critical. It's not too many neutrons, not too less. So this is what was achieved that day by Fermi. And that is the importance of second December. Morning the Met, they did something, and he was very confident. He was off, that is back for lunch, came back after lunch, then everybody is ready. There are, this is a cartoon, so many layers of graphite, okay? In that there are some uranium bonds, okay? Then there is a Geiger counter which click, 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 it speaks. But there is a chart recorder. When Geiger counter is too much, there is a strip chart recorder, it draws the plot which I showed you. Okay, even today, reactors are made critical, that kind of chart comes. Okay, then there is a danger. There is a, nobody has used a nuclear reactor so far, so it could not go super critical. So this man is standing with cadmium rod, pushing in, pushing out. But there is a fellow with an X, Kulhari. If there is too much of a problem, he will just cut this. So this rope, so this rod, zip, it will go in, okay? And that is called zip rod, okay? And the person is supposed to stop it. Yeah, no problem. Okay, so this is the cutting of that. But this one, I though it takes time, I'll quickly read because this is the heart of today's day. Okay, Anderson. He was American scientist, he's sitting there. What he writes? See, you put cadmium rods fully inside so that they keep absorbing neutrons. That is how even reactors today are made critical. Then slowly pull out. Of course, in our reactor, there are so many other things to do, removing the moderators and all that. But crudely, what Fermi did was pull out the cadmium rod slowly, 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 so that the neutrons multiply little more, little more, little more. And then Geiger counter to measure the counter. Now I'm reading quickly. And after that, we can even close this. So this is very important because that is the thrill. When the cadmium rod was pulled out of the position, Fermi asked for next. The increase in neutron intensity was noticeably quickened. At first, you could hear the sound of the neutron counter. Clickety, click, clickety, click. Okay. Click, click, click. There were the old Geiger counters. I mean, those people from atomic energy know it. Click, click, and there used to be some circles. And then the clicks came more and more rapidly. And after a while, they began to merge into a roar. Click, 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 click. The Geiger counters could not follow anymore. There's too many counts to count. That was the moment to switch on the chart recorder because it can take care of a larger count. When the switch was made, switching, changing from Geiger counter to chart recorder, everyone watched in this sudden silence, the mounting deflection of the recorder pen. Then goes on going up and up and up in the direction which I showed you on the graph. So it was an awesome sight. People were stunned. Okay? This is the moment for which they were living for 5 years. Everyone realized the significance of that switch. We were in the high intensity regime. The counters were unable to cope with the situation anymore. Again and again, the scale of the recorder had to be changed. Now you change the scale range so that more and more counters are accommodated in lockstep. Again and again, the scale of the recorder had to be changed to accommodate the neutron intensity, which was increasing more and more rapidly. Then he says, suddenly, Fermi raised his hand. Pi L has gone critical, he announced. No one present had any doubt about it. There were 43 people standing there, all were qualified, except one person was some journalist kept present for the sake of, like we have a journalist who is monitoring atomic energy, so one journalist who was following DuPont on those days. Okay. Then everyone began to wonder why he did not start the pile off. But the Fermi was completely calm. He was an extraordinary person, actually, he waited another minute, then another. Then when it seemed that anxiety was too much to bear, he ordered zipping. Okay. And Zin is the man of the scientist who is supposed to hold the rock. He just leaves the control rope. So it just goes in and dump all the sounds. And there was a sigh of relief when the neutron count dropped abruptly and obedient. So they knew that they had achieved something, but they were entering little 5 minutes before the danger zone. These were the pile seen from the top. Okay, the one rod which was to be dropped was from the top, rest was from the side. And this is the team after 43 were there. Okay, this man is Leo Szilard, Dr. Judith Fermi, there are many others. And okay, now we will go fast, because the title is And After. What happened after that? 2nd December 1942. Some 500 watt, something like that, the power. Then the pile was taken to Hanford. There is another site of Manhattan Project where they increased the pile strength to 200 watts. You look at the fun, 200 watts. When our Apsara in 1956, it was something like this, 1 kilowatt or something. So I don't know what it said. So then from that, they designed larger reactor, which is like this. What was this reactor meant for? This is the work which Fermi started to do, this reactor will do, creating transuranic elements. They wanted to get plutonium out of uranium-238. And so a reactor was built from which they will get that material which did not exist in nature. Okay? And this physics now we'll leave because we don't have time. And of course, then transuranic elements came, though Fermi was nowhere. And somebody else invented, other than plutonium. Plutonium also invented by Seberg and so many others, were also by Seberg and so many more people. But transuranic elements came in front of Fermi, but he was not the person. But it came, and that reactor was meant to create transuranic elements, plutonium in kilograms quantity. These are the plants who will extract plutonium from the used uranium. Okay, and you look at it. How much uranium is seen in life? They've seen 0.5 milligram of plutonium made in a sample of. Now they built a plant for kilogram. So Henry Smith is a Britisher. He wrote a story of this project. So no one in the right frame of mind would think of such a magnification of scale in peacetime. If there was no need like that, who will do like that? Half a milligram and then you want to extract 10 kilogram of plutonium from there. Okay? So, ultimately, they'll...
Again, it has gone, is it? Disconnected?
Yes, sir. Sound lost.
Okay. Jayaraman sir, I think we have to come in.
So Jayaraman sir also is not audible. I don't know what is the reason. Though his mic is on.
Yeah, that is true. Unable to hear you. We cannot hear you. There is some problem with your mic. Jayaraman sir. Okay, what nutshell, you know, I mean, looking at the balance number of slides which are there, Umesh, I'm sure you can share it. There are very few number of slides that is actually building up to the actual event which took place on in August, both the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing. I think, Umesh, you can share those slides for our audience. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Vaidya sir, should I share the slide and you can continue with the talk? Your mic is mute. Vaidya sir, your mic is mute.
Okay, am I heard now?
I can hear. Yeah, we can hear you now. I'm sharing your presentation. Rest, you can continue with.
No, I another 2-3 slides. Then I request Dr. Jayaraman to tell what is the present thing. So I will not. Take much time now. Jayaraman sir, few minutes.
Are you able to hear me?
I am able to hear you. Yes. Yeah. So what I request is another 2-3 slides, and then I'll skip out, and then please tell people what is the today's thing. So I will only show this, that this is the
Umesh after- go front. Yeah.
I'm heard, na? Okay. Should I continue?
Continue.
Okay. So Fermi's role was over. Whatever was to be done for the project was done, and the nuclear reactor was made possible.
Yes.
Now this is the Calderhall reactor in UK. This is the first commercial nuclear power plant. But USSR made in 1954 a small 5 megawatt electricity plant, and that was the first peaceful reactor. Peaceful. Other reactors were meant for, you know, weapons. But the thing is, today there are 442 reactors running and they're doing a good job for us. Though the first step was for the destructive use of science, but the ultimately good things also prevailed. Although the other part, as Mr. Kennedy himself was saying, that those weapons were tested and tested fine. But after that, 78 years, nothing has happened. Nobody has used any nuclear weapon. Okay. So much of 14% of world nuclear electricity comes from there. Okay. So now I will be skipping some slides and directly go to the last slide. This is how Hiroshima looks today. Okay. And that is the optimistic view of life. And Dr. Jayaraman would like to take up from there, that what started with destructive, how constructively people have made use. I hope I have conveyed, and Dr. Jayaraman will patch up wherever I lost the pulse of the listeners. Thank you very much to all of you, for the listeners and the both the organizations.
Dr. Vaidya, you actually skipped the most important part of it, which was there in your presentation.
Okay, already 1.5 minutes, so let us see what I missed. You want me to go back or Dr. Jayaraman?
the fat boy you missed.
No, I was willingly missing. I was willingly missing. 1 minute.
The fat man and the little boy.
The little boy and the fat man.
If you allow me to talk, I see. From 2nd December 1942 to 16th July 1945, it comes 30 months. We know Hiroshima happened on 6th August. We know Nagasaki happened on 9th August. But 16th July in Alamogordo, New Mexico desert, one weapon was tested. That was made of plutonium and not of uranium. Okay, they wanted to test it. And it worked. They were happy. Then our Szilard went around saying that this is too bad, don't put it on people. And that story I will reserve for another day. There is a lot of Frank report and you know, many things come. But the important part is, one is of course that Szilard's action, but what Szilard wrote to President Roosevelt to stop it. Now this matter was in hands of army. Army said the Szilard person is giving a lot of problems. He said, this paper what you are sending is very important. It should have an escort. So to send to president, He said, we have to give escort, but I don't have escort free now. So the letter reached President Roosevelt's table after he died. And President Truman took over, and etc. So we'll leave it. So this is the different design and the bomb which was put on Thin Boy. Why it's called Thin Boy? It's a different design, which is not like this. This is fat, and that is thin. There is a long barrel that was put on Hiroshima. And this is the status of Hiroshima. And what do I miss? I think I am not missing anything except that one thing about Fermi I'll connect here. 16th July, when the test was done, that was mounted on a machan, okay? The device. That time underground testing was not. It was mounted on a machan. 3 miles away, these people were, 3 or more miles away, these people were sleeping in a tent. Now, look at the Fermi's experimental skill. They are lying down. Fermi is the main man, though Villard is the project coordinator. Fermi wants to calculate what is the yield of the weapon, how much of power it has. So, whatever paper he had in pocket, he took and made it in pieces. And when the shockwave came to them in the tent, there was an order. Everybody put your face down, and because there is a bright flash. So, okay. Then this fellow, he got up, you know, from the knee, in kneeling, and in his hand he had a 1 inch, half an inch tukras of paper. He just flew it like this, and then again kneeled down, and then the shockwave came, and this papers swept across the tent and went to some distance. Everybody is joining celebration, this, that. This fellow is calculating. When I dropped at a particular point A, how far those pieces of paper went. From that, he calculated the yield of the weapon and how much of power it had. It had some less than 10 kT power. But that calculation, this man did it on the spot. And the person in charge of the project, General Gross, he's just stunned. He writes in his book that I was amazed at the skill of this man, who is not only experimentalist par excellence, personally, if you ask me, 20th century's Newton, he knew experiments so very well, he knew theory also so very well. Thank you very much. And
Thank you, sir.
For bringing him back, Kenneth, sir.
And now you can stop sharing. You can stop the sharing.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay. Now I am an audience.
I think may I request Dr. Jayaraman to actually pitch in and then, you know, maybe add on to what subsequently BARC has done. I mean, Dr. Vaidya asked you to, to fill up.
Am I audible?
Bilkul.
Yes.
Okay. Now, we had such an eye account of what happened on 1942. In the Chicago pile. So it's almost like an eye account with all the enthusiasm and the emotion captured. I just want to connect two or three historical points. The first point is, we will go to Richard Feynman. Richard Feynman asked all of us to do a thought experiment. If all the information available today is to vanish and disappear in the next moment, and if you are given an A-sheet paper and a pencil to write one sentence, what would that single sentence be? In a single sentence, you have to give the information density that is available today. Everything else is going. And this Nobel laureate asked the question and answered, all matter is made up of atoms, small little particles, which when they are very close by, they will repel. When they are a little apart, they will attract. From that single sentence, solitary sentence, it is possible for humanity to reconstruct all the knowledge we have. The atomic hypothesis is fundamental to our civilization. Step number one. Number two, the Lise-Meitner's work that the atom, which was called uncuttable, unbreakable, unsplittable, has been split. And the splitting of the atom is the next historic moment. The discovery of the atom, the splitting of the atom was the second reaction. The third reaction was what Dr. Paresh was telling us, the splitting in such a way that you have a self-sustained chain reaction. That is the Fermi's contribution. Now, when Fermi did it, a year later, Dr. Baba said, when nuclear energy has been successfully applied for power production, in a couple of decades from now, India will not have to look abroad but we'll find the experts at hand. Today, most of us who would otherwise have been lecturers in engineering college or in a government colleges or wherever it is, have come to a new profession called the nuclear energy profession. That was all because of the atom, the splitting of the atom, and the controlling of the chain reaction with what is known as the moderator. So that these are the three historic moments in human civilization. Summing it up, a great philosopher like our former president, Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, said, if we plunge this world into a nuclear accident, either by accident or design, we will go down in history not as responsible citizens, but as lunatics. And the verdict on history by civilization will be suicide in a state of unsound mind. Today, we have the capacity to make the deserts blue. We also have the capacity to make this a desert. So that power, the inherent power latent in the atom, has been discovered by science, and science has been able to tame it by appropriately moderating it. And the nuclear reaction is symbolic of the rational hope of humanity for a better living, including dealing with all the problems which we have with respect to global warming, with respect to climate change. The reactor and the neutrons, that will be the critical, single critical variable for human development and for the development of human development index. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It's indeed an honor and privilege that on behalf of the two organizing institutions, the Nehru Science Center and the National Center for Science Communicators, I wish to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Paresh Vaidya and also all the esteemed members who have joined us on this Zoom platform. Most of you are from BRC, different batches of the training school, and also some of the students who may have joined us on the YouTube platform. This recording is going to be there on the YouTube, and most of the students who will be interested in the days and years to come, there will be more and more number of people who will be watching this to understand the significance of the 2nd December 1942 and maybe the spin-off benefits that the countries like India have obtained from this, the possibilities of, you know, the fission reaction and other things. So once again, I would like to thank you all and hope to continue to be in touch with our esteemed audience. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you, Umesh.
You can, I think, stop broadcasting.